gonna see a Windwalker from Pogchamp at all, which probably means they're gonna use that rogue in sneaky ways.
Okay, let's see how sneaky they can get. We have two very different teams with two different playstyles that could create two different grand finals. Will it be a rematch? Or will it be an all-method grand final? We're going to start our best-of-three series right now.
Going into the Vault of the Wardens, very interested, Kalaris, like you mentioned, to see which Shell's Angels are we going to see today, as we have gotten back into that very hyper-aggressive pull that they did have mistakes on last time they went into this Vault of the Wardens.
Important thing as well, though, is Method Pogchamp is doing a pretty big pull themselves on the other side here. So Shell's Angels, though, doesn't look like they've lost anyone just yet. We haven't seen Heru really kind of ramp up in terms of the damage here to start things off. It really needs to be getting on point with that.
Yeah, you're seeing here Divine Field already kiting out, trying to drop his necrotic stacks. It is fortified, volcanic, and necrotic here. So he has a little bit of a timer into it where they're really trying to be able to get all the mobs in together, establish threat, establish aggro, and then as you see, Harrow just really ramping up in terms of damage, and he stood so much further back before he ended up engaging, something very important that he actually ended up fixing over the last time they went into Vault of the Warden.
Yeah, exactly. They played it safer this time around. Heru was talking to us at the start of the day as we sat down with him in the hotel, and usually it's up to him to really get that massive burst off early and then allow Doru to clean things up. But they almost played it a little bit safer there, but they get that 40%, and look how far they are already ahead here in Method Pogchamp.
Yeah, you're seeing actually Divine kind of jumped back into melee there to kind of help with the kiting that was going on to it. But you are seeing the mass entangling roots just trying to drop the necrotic stacks. You are already seeing the Purgatory going out, as of course you're seeing the mini boss Gladiana actually just taking down Divine and Syrah. They will be able to recover from this pull here. They will be able to actually get it down quickly, but you are seeing just the nice advantage that Shell's Angels has already established for themselves, even though they incurred two extra deaths in the process over Pogchamp. By getting that aggressive pull down pad, they've established a pretty substantial lead, real.
Yeah, definitely. Elzrat died on the other side here for Method Pogchamp. So that was a minor thing for him, and you're seeing actually Muscle Bar just head beyond some of this trash to potentially pull it on along with the rest of it. But let's see what Shell's Angel's going to do, because now they're at 50%. They can move up through some of this trash if they want. They're going to use that shroud to move around a little bit. I mean, 50% at this point here, before that first boss, is a phenomenal position for them to start in.
Yeah, it's incredible here as they're able to just move through the rest of these mobs here, get onto the RP effect that's going to be happening. I would have liked to be able to see maybe a Shine just kind of run ahead a little bit. Actually, yeah, did end up running ahead, getting the RP started. They are able to pull these extra mobs into the boss here to provide a little bit of extra cleave damage, get a little bit extra resources to the rogue to be able to pump out some single target damage here. So at this point, it is just the difference in terms of trash percentage.
Yeah.
Boss pull been a little bit closer, as you're seeing here, as they're dealing with Tirithon.
And he's probably, he goes into the Vengeance form first, correct? So you've got to watch out for the Mortar he's going to be doing, which is a little swirlies on the ground, which isn't too much bigger of a deal. And then also the two glaives are going to be thrown out, and you see the chain up on the top right-hand corner there for Shell's Angels. So they just got to dodge around. But as long as everybody is sticking with the group as people are moving, usually it's not that much of an issue. It's just kind of Divine Field dictating where he's going to go with everyone following.
Yeah, and they're doing a great job actually keeping their distance from a lot of the extra trash they pulled into the boss here. Avoid the extra necrotic stacks that they really don't want to have to be dealing with here. So having good distance and also doing a great job being able to kite out the rest of these mobs while moving in the direction of the new fell elementals that Tirithon does end up spawning here.
And that's the thing. So usually what you see here when you have a rogue in your party accompanying you in these dungeons, you will see a lot of the trash or some of the trash packs later on down the line attempted to maybe take to bosses with them. It always does help a little bit in terms of some AoE. It's a bit more difficult with things like Glazer, things like Ashgorn to actually take to. But Inquisitor, you can benefit a lot because there are just natural adds with those. And likewise, sometimes you see even dogs come with it. They might even skip that depending on what they want to do here because they already got to the 50%.
Yeah, and many times, like you said, you will see some of the extra Scorchers or Defiler dogs taken away. I think at this point, they should be able to skip a lot of those if only having to pull maybe a handful of them at this point. Whereas Pogchamp will, like you said, actually have to engage with them during the boss fight. Shouldn't be too bad for them to really deal with here. But in terms of DPS, so close together, Pogchamp and Shell's Angels here. You're seeing because Doru is playing Boomkin, having to mix in all the extra damage and being able to actually still move and cleave down a lot of those adds a little bit faster, you are seeing a Shine kind of just going a little bit lower in terms of DPS from the starting burst that he really was able to pump out there.
Bear in mind, let's talk about the kind of the mentality of these two teams coming into this instance as well, because Method Pogchamp, these two teams know each other so well because they're both Europe and Europe. And Method Pogchamp knows that Shell's Angels, this is a good map for them, so they expect to be behind a little bit going into this map, as long as Shell's Angels is able to get their first pull off. They don't know the progress of each other just yet, but Method Pogchamp is, in their mind, I feel, planning for the long term in this series. So planning, I feel, for all three maps, since this is such a good map for Shell's Angels.
Not only is it an excellent map for them, but it's also looking at the consistency of Shell's Angels and how well Pogchamp is able to capitalize on top of that, right? Knowing that any map can be theirs if they're able to plan accordingly for it. If they're able to say, we know our routes, we know how we're going to be able to establish it. And we've seen so many times where Shell's Angels has kind of come up a little bit short here, and they haven't actually been able to execute as well as Pogchamp on average, right?
Yeah.
They're saying, if any moment in time, you know, they're messing up on large pulls, as we saw Shell's Angels, for example, you know, not be able to execute very well in a 24 vault, you know, they're saying, we're just able to capitalize on this, we're going to be able to beat you.
Well, I mean, for me, when you talk about that, the consistency coming out from Method Pogchamp, whilst they're dealing with this imp, obviously you saw them, you know, taking both sides, pulling all the imps together very quickly and going on to the Foul Mother now. For me, Method Pogchamp is the surgeon's knife. Very clinical, very, very precise. Shell's Angels is a sledgehammer, man. They just come in and want to pull big, big pulls and smash them into the ground. Oh, Sev's going very low on this Foul Mother, but does not die, does not prop perg, by the looks of things at least. So Shell's Angels going to be moving on along with Method Pogchamp.
Yeah, they're doing an excellent job here.
Oh, he did prop perg.
Oh, yeah, you did it on Park and Perg. There's so many necrotic stacks that ended up just building for him. You just had to sit through Perg. I believe he actually did end up getting a bit of a refresh, though. It was important to make sure you're able to kind of get the distance, especially when you have a lot of the imps that, you know, spawn a little bit later after the mass grip comes out. There's still a couple of them here and there that can cause a bit of issues here. So you're seeing 15% difference in terms of trash coming out here. Four extra deaths on the side of Shell's Angels as they're both sides are about to engage with Dramatic right now.
Interesting that they are going to take the dogs with this as well, and actually quite a few dogs, wow. But again, A-Shine will get a heavy benefit from this. You already see that starting at the very beginning, trying to pump Inquisitor down as fast as possible here. 86% on the other side here, Method Pogchamp. These two teams going up against one another, it's really cool to see how they are doing in terms of progression against one another. But again, Shell's Angels has that boon of that instant trash at the beginning, and Inquisitor has plenty of abilities that are annoying.
Oh, plenty of abilities. You're also seeing the Chidesh popping on the shot of A-Shine as they actually end up killing both Scorchers in short order with each other here. That's one of the things is when you're having to deal with, you know, Doru Starfall actually cleaving down a lot of those mobs, it's a little bit of a timer for how well the Rogue's able to pump out some single target damage. Then the Starfall and any of the extra cleave going on just actually annihilates them. But by that point, you're able to get into the next set of mobs
exactly.
Here, next set of prisons, and the first one coming up in the Demon Wing, where again, A-Shine can just start pumping in more single target.
Yeah, so it's unlike other bosses where you're like, oh, I would love to keep that trash alive for the duration of the boss. No, you don't need that because you're going to have these waves constantly coming along. So they're dealing with this quite nicely on the side of the Demon Prison. And then actually we're seeing Method Pogchamp using the line of sight strategy on their side. It's a little bit more costly in terms of time, but at least you're able to group things up and have it in a nice concise area.
Yeah, they do an excellent job on both sides making sure they're killing the Warlock. It's always important to make sure you're kicking the Seed of Corruption that goes out. After that, you do have to be dealing with the Enforcer mob that comes out as well, which will be charging different players and being such a large annoyance there. So they do a great job on the side of Pogchamp, you know, making sure it's a focus, taking it down quickly here. And as you said, you know, they're going to take a little bit more time and they're a little bit behind in terms of boss HP because they are kind of waiting for everything to get, you know, brought back into them here. But it would be interesting to see if, you know, part of that is because they're running with the double casters and they want to make sure that they're able to kind of protect them. And then they also are not having to move at round as much to be able to dodge any of the disorient effects going out.
It's part of that clean style again, right? It feels like Method Pogchamp is just playing their own game. They know that Shell's Angels is good here. They're just hoping that they screw up on the other side. Now we're into the old Godwing, and Shell's Angels right on top of that, looking to power that down as well. Plenty of damage coming out here from Doru as he's able to cleave all this quite nicely. Tormenting Orbs extra do spawn. And one thing that's important to note here is that Sebs has gone down on the other side, and they do not have reses.
They don't actually have any battle res available. Looks like they're just dropping pylons here. They have about half a minute or so before their next battle res comes back up. So they look like they're just going to drop pylons here. They really don't have any other choice to be able to actually deal with this. And this is kind of the disaster scenario. Is Shell's Angels already was having a sizable advantage here in terms of trash and boss percentage and everything like that. Now you're wiping on top of that, and it always goes from, you know, maybe we know that Shell's Angels is going to be really strong in this map, but if we're also playing and having some inconsistencies here, it's just going to kind of compound on each other, on itself.
Yeah, there may be a point here in Meth and Pogchamp's mind where they're like, okay, this is very unlikely that we're going to be able to catch up here, unless Shell's Angels has one or even two wipes as they're taking down. This mini-boss going to be moving on to our next bosses here, slowly with the Fell Scorchers being taken down, and with the Solar Beam actually being able to kind of lock them in, well, at least lock down their inability to cast anything while this is happening.
Yeah, very important to note that they are putting the X on, or sorry, the Skull onto the Scorchers here, because that will drop them extremely low when they do end up dying. Next Scorchers are about 15%, 10% HP here, so they do a great job making sure that they actually spread out and space out the deaths of the Scorchers, because that previously was what proc the Shine's cheap death here. So very important to make sure that you're going to see it dropping low in just a second here as the next one goes off. How much damage goes out just from those mob being killed?
And with them being at 90% now after this, and they'll even go up a little bit more, they have the opportunity here with the 100% even completed. A-Shine now can use things like Shroud later on to skip some of those mini-bosses between, you know, like when you've finally finished Ashgorm, going down to maybe the final tunnel, the dark tunnel, but going up against Glazer here, just a few things to really point out. Obviously, you want to kind of be in melee range, or at least in the path of where the orbs are going, and then being able to move out of the way of them so that they will eventually come back and hit Glazer. You can see they're positioning themselves right here, down towards the bottom corner. You can actually get a little quicker knockback on some of the orbs down towards the bottom, so they come back and hit Glazer just a little bit faster. Of course, if it's in the middle, then everything can, in theory, come back faster, but it's by the by.
Yeah, and at this point, they're just making sure they're doing a great job of watching their positioning, trying to get everything back into it as best as they can. The orbs will target the nearest player, of course, when they start bouncing back here, so ideally, you want to make sure you're getting all the detonations in there, because, of course, the orbs will ramp up in speed over time. Right here, just trying to kill the overloaded lens before you start moving the rest of the mirrors, so that Glazer will redirect his light back into himself, thus breaking his immunity shield here, as Pogchamp's at 40% here, trying to be able to get back into the game.
It was pretty close there, actually, but they do get it turned around and good to go by the looks of things. It's just taking a little while to proc, and then it will bounce off all of these mirrors. And wait a minute, did that go the wrong way for a second?
They just need to move that last mirror there, that way they'll be able to redirect everything else that's going to be happening.
Okay, I think they're
having a little bit of issues here, as Shine and Hera are just ended up going down. Looks like they just had some kind of mistake going on to this one. So looks like they're just dropping pylons here and going to be able to res up. And at this point, that's what Pogchamp really needs to be able to get back into this.
Absolutely. That very uncommon error there going on from Shell's Angels. Normally that's very clean cut, but the other side here, Inquisitor, down to 20% right now. They're having a bit of a better time with it here, killing off this old god wing, and then from there it's okay. So Inquisitor as well has an ability that will slow down the cooldowns of your next ability that you do cast. So sometimes you have to be a little bit selective with what you want to cast right after that, so that you can just get back on with your old merry work.
Yeah, at this point, 5% left on its momentum for Pogchamp here. Probably going to be going on to Glazer like we saw with Shell's Angels there. Very weird situation. I was trying to figure out what was going on. You know, Sierra actually had great positioning, making sure they were kind of standing out of the way of everybody. But I think that at that point, they just messed around with the mirrors and just had too many deaths as they were just hitting too many of the orbs. And a lot of it, I think, was just kind of on their more poor positioning and allowing all the orbs to kind of start going off all over the place. And as like I said, over time, they will just accelerate so much. So it's really important to make sure they have strong positioning at the beginning here, getting all four of those orbs to collapse back into the boss here before they actually end up going to that intermission phase.
Yeah, and again, you know, we mentioned it before, while Shell's Angel still needs to kind of, well, they had that wipe, and that's good for Method Pogchamp. I felt like there needs to at least be two wipes on their side for Method Pogchamp to really catch up because of those huge pulls Shell's Angels did at the beginning. And we're seeing that overload lens once again being focused down. And this time they have a little bit of room to be able to get these mirrors nicely up and running, so they will all be lined up and good to go.
Yeah, right here, they're just making sure they're connecting all the mirrors here, which will then put a very substantial vulnerability debuff onto Glazer here, so you're going to see him taking very high additional damage that he'll be able to quickly burn down the boss going into this. Also interesting, when they're at that 100% HP mark, they will be able to skip past the Jailer to be able to go into the elevator from there.
Yeah.
But it'll also be interesting because they do have to kill at least one of the Avatars of Vengeance to be able to open the gates up to Cordana here, so it'll be interesting if they're going to be able to avalanche, then visibility potion past not only the spiders, but if they'll be able to skip past some of the brood mothers as well to get right on top of the Avatar of Vengeance. It'll be a pretty quick run.
Yeah, there's that one brood mother in particular just in front of the Avatar of Vengeance that's kind of the most problematic one because it is so close to that eventual like running out of the potion and things like that. But they've killed off Glazer. Now it's time to head over to Ashgorm. She can take a nice little side path through. No trash down there. So can skip nicely to him. And now we're time to have some good old icy fire moments.
That's right. Things will be heating up here as going into Ashgold. As Pogchamp is on to 85% onto Glazer here, they will be pushing into the transition phase soon and looking to just get as much burst damage as possible onto it here. Big thing with Ashgold here is you will be having a couple of the little freezing traps that you will be able to deploy, which will then put a vulnerability debuff onto Ashgolem, allowing you to take, you know, deal increased damage to him for about, you know, 10, 20 seconds very quickly here. Always important to watch out for any of the volcanoes that he will be spawning. And right as he gets out of this phase, he will be spawning a number of volcanic circles, which if you pick them up, will put a substantial dot onto you. And if they hit any of the fell elemental, or sorry, the fire elementals he spawns a little bit later, will cause them to detonate for a substantial amount of damage.
And some of those little patches that he puts on the floor are in lines. And actually, it's not 100% obvious to the layman that there's a little gap in between some of them that you can actually run through, because technically there's like almost a connection between the, some of the patches in that line, but you can actually walk through that a little bit. Divine Field just going to soak some of that up to begin things off, and there's the lines. You can see a small little gaps on, well, this one's a really big gap on the left-hand side. Ignore that one. That's not the one I mean. The ones in between the other patches, and just moving it away from that volcano as well. So good stuff from them.
I love Sierra's damage going into this. He's been sustaining over 2 million for, you know, over half of the boss fight here, doing such an excellent job being able to consistently pumping out huge damage. This is really what we wanted to see, is that at this point, you're the only person you really need to be able to heal is maybe yourself or maybe the group if one of those explosions goes off like it does right there. And at that point, it's a quick flash into Virtue used, and then he's able to get everybody topped off just enough, and then you're leaning on DK's Leech to be able to do the rest. So
yeah,
fantastic damage here by Sierra. This is really what we want to be able to see out of healers in general, of being able to just cut as many corners as possible to be able to pump out that big damage. You are seeing Divine Field actually falling down into the gap there, actually dying surprisingly there. They are having Hero going down because they, another one of the flame elementals did end up exploding here. So at this point, Divine does go down. It's not too big of a deal because they'll be able to burn the rest of the boss. He'll be able to actually release and be right at the front there, but a little bit of a simple mistake that they really want to be able to avoid, as they now have, you know, five more deaths over their opponents.
Unless this is the sickest play ever and he's going
to
be lowering one of the mini bosses.
Shortcut.
Yeah, exactly. That would be pretty sick, to say the least. I mean, technically, he couldn't try and move the boss, but he's not moving any further forward, so that's not going to be the case. But Ash Golem in general is one of the less threatening bosses, I feel, in this instance, especially on Fortified, so it's not too big a deal for the healing. And that's why you see Sierra doing so much. It's really cool.
Mm-hmm. And it depends on what you want to be able to see. Sometimes you can have your tank just be able to run ahead, drag off the Jailer to the side.
Exactly.
But what it also causes, it takes so much longer to actually be able to, you know, get the res off, then you're waiting for the elevator. A lot of it is just not too time efficient, really, to be able to do. Always important when you actually have that invisibility potion up to make sure that you have your avalanche potion buff already up, and then you keep on jumping as you're going over a lot of these webs here, as you're going to see Divine Field doing as best as he can here. Then they're going to be able to have to deal. They're probably not going to have enough invisibility duration for to be able to get the Broodmother, get past the Broodmother and on top of the Spirit of Vengeance.
Yeah.
So they're just waiting for the rest of the squad to be able to come up with them. It shouldn't be too bad, because all they have to do is kill the Avatar, make sure they're able to open up the gates, and as the rest of the group takes down the Broodmother, Sierra's going to be able to run ahead and start the RP for Cordana.
I don't know how Divine Field made it all that way without the light. I need my nightlight, man, in here. I'm scared. There's spiders everywhere. But regardless, yeah, he's just waiting for the rest of the team now, and let's see how they're going to pull this off. I mean, Shell's Angels is one of those teams that really loves, even if they're at, like, real... good job, Doro. Even if they're at the... very towards the boss and at 100% trash, they still like to have adds along with them just to get a little bit of extra damage for A-Shine. There's the throwdown for the light. Doro will join them in a second, and now they're going to kill off this trash to eventually get to the boss.
Yeah, and at this point, like I said, they're just dragging everything in. The Spirit of Vengeance is going to be the targeted focus here, as Doro is just going to catch up with the rest of the group here. Killing that Vengeance opens up the gates. They'll be able to have Sierra run up ahead, be able to start the RP with Cordana here. As Mythic Pogchamps here, 35% left onto Ashgold, and they just need to be able to do something to kind of catch up back into this. But Shell's Angels has the trash percentage they need. They are a couple deaths ahead in terms, which isn't too bad here, but they just have such a substantial lead as they're going to be entering into Cordana here. It's looking so strong out of them.
And obviously Cordana here has a few things that you got to be watching out and be mindful of as they do eventually move up. Not only the RP, which takes a little while, and as you say, that's why they're going to go and trigger that, but also you actually lose your initial light and then have to go pick up this light. You don't want want to. That would be a bit OP. Actually, now that I think about it, that would be really sick. I like that. But regardless, I'm going to be throwing that on towards Kodana. And she's got a few abilities, of course. She has a glaive that she's eventually going to throw out sometimes that you just got to be a bit careful of, that you got to avoid. And then from that point on, eventually there's phases where she does disappear, and then you kind of have to find her, right?
Yeah, and having to use that light. And unfortunately, you know, you only get one nightlight, buddy. And otherwise, you just have to have all the lights on all the time here. Shell's Angels engaging with Kordana here. Always important to make sure everybody is stacked up for that glaive. The glaive will basically activate after it leaves about 10 to 15 yards away from her, so it's important to make sure you're stacked up right on top. It will pass through you as long as you're very close into the boss here, and then we'll come back inside, back into her. As you're seeing, the Avatar of Shadow gets popped up, where she will then hide away. Important to kill the Avatar of Shadow, which will release the nightlight for you. Then you have to be able to throw the light back onto her, which will reveal her once again to be able to burn down to the 50% mark.
Yeah, and then you've got the walls. Did you talk about the walls? I can't remember if you
talked. Walls are coming up.
The walls are coming up. The walls are coming up, and that's why we have this camera angle right here, because those walls are a scary little mechanic that you got to deal with. Of course, the nightlight is going to be moving over towards these puddles and getting rid of them. Why are we calling them nightlight the whole time? I've caused a problem here. I've caused a problem. but basically, eventually, Kordana will disappear. The walls will begin, and those are walls that are partially invisible for the most part, unless you're actually very close to them with the light. And thankfully, when they spawn, you can see the gap in them at the very beginning. So usually people are mindful of that, and then they'll just be able to move around. And there's four walls in total. It's like a little maze.
Yeah, it's always important to make sure you're scouting out where they're going to be going here, as you will have that first set of walls end up spawning. And they're going to kind of hang back here, just wait for to see where the next set of walls is. As you're seeing, they're able to actually move through, get into one spot where they're able to actually dodge through both of them at once. Always making sure that they're watching, you know, the positioning of the entire group. Everyone's staying together here. Then they're, again, going to be able to see in the bottom left where the next gap is going to end up being, having whoever actually has the light available to them. And then, again, waiting for that next second, the second wall to be able to spawn as to where they want to be able to line themselves up.
So now they want to move down to the bottom right-hand corner here, eventually with the boss, and they will already throw the light there to get this positioned, because that's where your next ad is going to spawn when Kordana might try and do something.
Yep, and when the ad spawns, it does end up shielding Kordana. They're actually putting the light there ahead of time. If you stun it, stun the mob, which they're having Sierra do right there, that way he's actually able to get his Cephus proc, it will allow you just to be able to put the shield down, so Sierra gets that quick stun off onto it, and then Ashine follows it up with a blind there to make sure that the mob's actually just not going to be in the way, it's not going to actually bother them, and everybody is able to have as high uptime as possible onto the boss without switching targets, without actually losing any kind of uptime onto Kordana here. 9% left onto it, as such a strong performance here by Shell's Angels, with a lot of it being riding on that very first pull that they were working on executing here. Phenomenal job by Shell's Angels taking game one.
Absolutely. I mean, that pull is the 45% that they get compared to the 22% or 24% that you see from the start of Method Pogchamp. So really good start from them. Great execution.
And the main thing is Shell's Angels, they tried to do it yesterday. They weren't able to pull it off, and that is why they found themselves in this situation. They need to win this series to get to the grand final. Their road to redemption has already started, but even in this run, we saw that Shell's Angels, not invincible by any means. Will Method Pogchamp be able to come back after this loss here on the first dungeon? Keep in mind what is at stake in this matchup. It will determine who plays against Method NA in the grand final. We're either gonna have that rematch with Shell's Angels, or it will be an all Method grand final. And Shell's Angels can definitely be happy with that victory there. Very well played by them, and it may be the resurgence that they need to take down the entire series here. We're gonna be jumping to a quick break, but do not go anywhere. The next dungeon could decide who will go to the grand final.
Is this your guys' first time meeting everyone together here in person?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
We know each other by name, but not much more than that.
I met JB once.
The online gaming community is kind of like Never Neverland and Peter Pan. People just don't grow up. Nobody has any kind of an idea of, you know, what can I expect when I'm up on stage? What's that going to feel like?
We never played like on a stage like this, so choking factor might actually affect us. We have cameras, you have lights, you have Snoopy in the front.
I'm actually worried about the younger people. We've got some 18-year-olds here now, and they're going to be pretty anxious, I imagine.
It was 1 second that finish.
What?
Yeah.
Coming on land and then having a few hundred thousand people potentially watching on Twitch, and I think when they walk onto that stage, it'll become real for them as they realize the cameras are rolling and the casters are right there.
we're actually more efficient here than from home. We sit next to each other, so if someone is checking 9gag or someone is on desktop all the time watching YouTube videos, I'm gonna be like, motivation is always good.
Yeah.
If you play for like 14 hours a day.
Just chilling in the practice room, like you want to tell the person, you just like turn to them and like say it, and you're like, well, you're actually like, you mean it.
For me as a healer, it's really nice. We've sat my tank right next to me, so you know I can feel when he's struggling. And I can just, you know, get in there and help him. My boomkin's not giving me the innovate. He's right there, give me a little nudge.
I'm just here to have a good time. It's so sick. I mean, you see all the Europeans on like that ranking ladders and stuff, and you're like, yo, so that's the guy behind the computer. That's the guy behind all the rank ones. I just think it's fun seeing everyone from around the world come together for a little WoW tourney.
Jump in, let's have a race. That is not the case here. We are seeing a team for the first time counterpick Maw of Souls, and this is going to be a Maw of Souls unlike anything that we have seen before. If this counterpick does not work, that is the end of the tournament for Method Pogchamp, and Shell's Angels will get to go to the grand final for the rematch. Will Method Pogchamp be able to pull this off?
Yeah, but you see now, slight difference in the pulls going forward. Pogchamp is actually opting to skip the jailer up ahead, where Shell's Angels is diving right in, pulling it along with it. Both groups are going to be, of course, having to engage with Ymiron as the first boss. Shell's Angels kind of holding off and making sure they're clearing out the trash first, while Pogchamp not shying away here, grabbing everything into Ymiron here.
So the big reason I was so surprised coming into this is, even on like 23s, 24s Tyrannical, everything, a lot of stuff in here can just one-shot you out of nowhere. But 25 is insane, and you're already seeing Doru actually go down here to start things. Shell's Angels is playing this as carefully as possible. Meanwhile, Method Pogchamp, if they've practiced this enough, it is such a notorious dungeon at plus 25 with Tyrannical, they could just rock it ahead.
At this point, they really have shown how far ahead that they can be, but already burning down the first 25% of the boss, while Shell's Angels is regrouping, just about to have the pull here. They were able to get such strong cleave damage onto everything going into this. And at this point, you know, Ymiron already putting out the first set of adds after the, you know, the Snows of Northrend coming out. A bunch of those different ads. It's always important to note you can't stun or slow or CC any of the ads too well, so he's just trying to do whatever he can to maybe get a little bit of a speed ahead of them to kind of kite it out just a bit before any of those dark slashes come out, which deal a tremendous amount of damage.
Shells with a little bit of percentage advantage in terms of that trash, and going to be taking Ymiron a very, very stable and steady here. This is not going to be our sledgehammer Shells Angels that we saw in some past instances. This is going to be them playing careful. I don't think they expected more of Souls really coming out as the counter, to be honest.
And that's why you see them playing carefully, is that any dungeon that they end up practicing, they are theory crafting, they're observing it any way that they can gain some sizable advantage on in terms of trash. You know, a lot of times I think many groups kind of get into this rut of saying, okay, there's only, you know, there's some designated ways that we can do this, and we're going to do this, and we hope that we have better single target damage, or we'll try to amp up our single target damage over it. You're seeing Kjell going down there, getting a quick battle res out onto him here, who will be able to just get him topped off quickly. As you've seen, the boss don't go down to 33%, but most of Shell's Angels has been pulling as much trash as possible to be able to gain an advantage here, and when they were playing a little bit more shy, a little bit more safe here, going for the very first pause, it kind of shows that they're lacking preparation on it.
Absolutely. I mean, you got to keep the kiting on this boss as well. There's a lot of extra adds here that if the boss and the little adds are whacking away at Sebs, for example, and you just get any tank, you are going to get trashed completely. So you got to be very careful. 16% right now to the 44%. As much as they lost one person here on the other side for Shell's Angels, they still have that battle res available. That could be very impactful later on Hellier, for example. All of the bosses are terrifying.
Yeah, very terrifying to always watch out for. And one of the nice things about having the Warlock is if you need to be able to have that kind of taunt come in, you are able to have your Infernal, for example, get the quick taunt out onto it, take the Dark Slash instead. That's why you're seeing SJ's damage be a little bit on the lower end here, because he keeps on resummoning his Infernal, getting it to taunt for, you know, about every other Dark Slash comes out. It gets instantly wiped out, but the tank gets so much less pressure on him, it makes it a lot easier.
Going into the boat now here for Method Pogchamp, and there's a lot of trash that you can pull at the same time. And it's kind of, this is some of the trash that players love the most here at the Mythic Dungeon Invitational, because it's a lot about positioning. Can you avoid barrels? Can you avoid slashes once they go into that kind of wraith form, etc.? So as long as you're being mindful about how you're positioning around this while still dishing out as much damage as possible, this is exactly where Method Pogchamp wants to thrive.
Yeah, at this point, you know, it's such a tight corridor they have to be watching out for, not only because of the barrels, but also dealing with the affix of quaking. Yep. You are seeing, of course, Musclebrock going down there. Holy Avenger and Devotionor are up for Elsrad here as he's trying to make sure he's able to top off and stay stabilize his group here. They did a good job being able to actually deal with the last of the bursting stacks here, but there still is a very tight window that they have to be able to actually move these adds out of, spreading out for Quaking and being able to deal with the rest of these mobs as they're dropping quite low here.
Sev's just trying to kite, but still wants a little bit of damage out here and there. Would love to just drop his Death and Decay in there, try and get some Blood Boils off, Blood Drinker if he needs it on just one of the targets. But again, it's providing him a lot of sustain whilst moving back. And also with bursting effects in this instance, you know, you see them not going too gung-ho on pulling a ton of stuff, but there are still those moments where a lot of damage is going on. Sometimes the teams will call once some of the mobs are going to die off. Okay, stop DPS.
Yeah, but at this point, you're seeing Dr. J getting bopped, being able to actually bring all the adds off to the side over here. Very important to note, you want to have a very large distance between you and the Mariner in particular. The Mariner will have his just Lantern of Darkness, which deals an incredible amount of damage to the entire group here. But if you are actually getting distance away from the Mariner very early on, you will not cast it, and you'll actually be able to kite it away here. So that's where you're seeing Dr. J waiting for the Mariner to actually be at the foot of the stairs, tagging it, then running off to the right side to be able to just pull everything together, get his invis off, and make sure they're able to quickly sneak by here. So great moves by Dr. J to be able to make sure that the group is going to be not only safe, but they're also able to quickly just grab a couple of the extra dogs here to make things even better for the trash percentage.
They're going to take these two champions to the boss as well by the looks of things, and this is an interesting pull going into it, of course. This boss is lethal in its own right with the two champions there as well. They're going to have to be mindful of interrupting those champions while still dealing with some of the adds that Harbron is going to be spawning, killing those off, interrupting them if it needs be, and then after this, I'm really interested to see how they're going to pull all the boat, but let's talk about Harbron.
Harbron, real quick, as you've seen the Cosmic Scythes going out there, will just be the definitive one-shot mechanic happening very consistently going out from him. You also will be spawning a number of Servitors, which usually are going to end up spawning on top of the ranged players here. And then, of course, you're going to be seeing the Purple Void Zones that will be regularly coming out throughout the fight. Very important for ranged players to make sure they're moving in the direction where, you know, Void Spawns are not or are, you know, have recently dissipated to. You want to make sure that you're kind of allowing the rest of your group to be moving on to where the clear areas are, and also having your melee, which is usually going to be, like we're seeing right here, neck deep in any of these void zones,
yep,
moving steadily away from it as best as they can here. So a lot of times you may want to be seeing SJ and Dr. J just standing as close together as possible to make sure you have a consistent area where the Servitors will spawn.
And Method Pogchamp looks very practiced at this. I mean, as much as I'm saying, oh yeah, it's risky to bring the champions with you, you want to have to interrupt them whilst it's going on, it's still important for them. It's almost a necessity in their mind that they bring them, so Uncle Muscle can get some damage done, but Syrah's gone down.
Zero's gone down with no battle res left available to them as they're at 85% on Tyrannical here. As you hear, you're going to see the pylons just going down as Doru is down, Hero is down. Going to get the rest of the group just to wipe it up very quickly here. They're just not going to be able to burn the boss down, just down the healer. It will be very important to make sure they're just getting the res up very quickly here, getting their food buffs, getting themselves reorganized here as they're going to go back into it. Substantial advantage here in the favor of Pogchamp.
Yeah, not too bad at all here at all with that Harbron at 55%. Still, it's a very long boss fight. Things could still go wrong.
Yeah, but you see the fragment going out here as they have to be stacking up together. You are seeing Dr. J going down as they were not able to quickly just kill the rest of the fragments, and it was just so much damage that gets put into the target who was affected by fragments. You have to kill all four little copies to be able to, you know, remove the dot from the player here.
Yep.
They don't have any battle res left available to them, and the boss is at 45%. This is that horrible situation that the teams can get into where they have so much of the boss's HP left to them, and to be able to actually burn down and nothing left available to get them up.
Yeah, it took ages to kill these bosses on Tyrannical on 25. And this gives the Shell's Angels a little bit of an opportunity to catch up. Exactly the same trash percentage, it's just that kind of 40% in the base of this boss that really does cause some issues. And again, still, it's like knock-on effect, right? Once you've lost one member of DPS on Harbron, then it gets harder for your other DPS to stay alive. Shell going very, very low there because you can't kill off these fragments that quickly. And he's, thankfully Warlocks have a lot of cooldowns available to them with the help of Elzerat as well.
That's right, and thankfully they were able to actually not have to worry about a combination of having Servitor and the fragments at the same time, because that would really start testing their ability to get all the interrupts off that they're going to need to right here. So it would be very important to make sure they're watching that later on, because this boss fight is far from over on the side of Pogchamp. They will still be having to deal with more fragments.
Yep.
They really got to work on just saving any kind of resources that they can to be able to quickly annihilate them here. As you're saying, SJ getting another set of fragments onto him, taking very heavy any damage here. It's all going to be on Elzrat to make sure he's sustaining him. You are seeing Devotion Aura going out to just try to reduce a little bit of the brunt of the force that's going out onto him. Seeing DFA being held onto to make sure they're able to quickly just finish off the rest of the fragments there. So good plan there.
Yeah, if he's got Dark Pact on Ending Resolve as well, maybe that can help out. Haru's gone down, though. They were catching up in terms of percent, but with that one death, that means now they're going to be in exactly the same situation. And actually, Windwalker Monks are pretty darn good at dealing with those fragments once they come along from these members. So it's not exactly the best of losses here. Harbor on, though, 21% on the side of Method Pogchamp. And you can see just how we have been in this fight for minutes now. So it's a real test of endurance.
It's a test of endurance and stamina. SJ, again, getting the fragment, having to be able to deal with it here, getting everything stacked up together, keeping it together. He must have actually procking his cheat death here. Very important to watch out for that. It will be very dangerous going into the, you know, the deck pull coming up right after this boss without having a cheat death available to him here. So we'll put a lot of stress onto the healer here and just a lot of stress onto the melee to be playing perfectly as we're going forward into this. 12% here on the side of Mythic Pogchamp to compare to 43% on the side of Shell's Angels. Always important to make sure you just keep on going through the motions, and while it can be exhausting to be able to go through, both teams are about to be able to get their battle reses back available to them, so it'll be very important to watch out what they're going to do here.
God, it must be such a relief to even just have one battle res on a dungeon like this in your pocket, but again, it could quite easily be expended as easy as that. I mean, for Shell's Angels, there's a part of me in my mind that's like, do you use it here? Because 33% takes a long time on something like Harboron, but at the same, because imagine, for example, if they couldn't kill some of those fragments down the line because they only have the two DPS and they lose another member, it would be catastrophic, and starting this boss again is almost GG.
Yeah, but they do actually end up resing arrow there as Pogchamp does have 5 seconds left on Bloodlust here as they're getting everything in together. A lot of CDs are going to have to be popped here to make sure they're going to burn everything down. It's going to be extremely dangerous pulling the side of Pogchamp here. It'll be interesting to see if they're going to hold on to Bloodlust going into Hellia, for example, here. At this point, they're able to just start kiting back, start getting away from a lot of these mobs. And a lot of it does kind of put the timer on the head of the players here, how long they're going to be able to stay in melee and be able to deal with all these mobs and shutting down any of the course of the Mistweavers that will be trying to actually top off the rest of the group.
Seb's going low, so was Elzrat, but they've managed to move away. Seb's just going to start the kiting phase here now, as Shell can easily get that slow on them if needs of it and available. And at the same time, Harbron and 7%. Shell's Angels trying to catch up the best to their ability. It is difficult, though. Dr. Joe going quite low, keep himself alive on the other side of all of this, with Shell just constantly pumping out those Seeds of Corruption, sow the seeds as well, get as much damage, but they're all kind of scattered right now. It's going to be a little bit more difficult to really get all these kills off in an efficient manner.
Yeah, at this point, they're just trying to overlap a lot of the mobs.
Yeah.
And many times you'll see the Mistcallers, not Mistweavers, sorry. a lot of times you'll see the Mistcallers just trying to get their casts off or trying to have the Surging Waters cast or any of the extra heal that can happen from them. Overlapping them over the champions that will be kind of just chasing off after the tank here. So important to be able to do whatever you can to get everything stacked up together. Seb's dropping incredibly low here, making sure he's able to get topped off is Elzrat, popping wings, having Devotion Aura back available to just help stabilize the rest of the group and be dealing with a lot of the bursting that is going out as they're going to be moving on to Skjall to wrap up their trash percent.
Shell's Angels playing this a bit more slower. They've taken about half of the boat and they're going to kill that off all in Solar Beam to begin things. There's still more packs that they're going to have to deal with later on. At least this alleviates some of their worries and doubts since they don't actually have a battle res. I mean, it's not as important here really here on trash, but ultimately you just want to be as fast as possible, and I think they know at this point that, you know, it's been a bit problematic for them. Method Pogchamp has taken a sizable lead going onto this mini boss.
They really have, and a big thing with Skjall is always watching out for is just the leap that he will be putting out onto one player or even in some cases onto some pets. Always important to make sure that you're watching out for the give no quarter as we'll just be leaping to that target, dealing a huge chunk of damage here, which can be extremely dangerous for players.
Yeah.
And then periodically, he will be spawning any of the Skeletal Warriors, and of course, having his Interruptible Cast, which will cause players to take more damage.
That's right. Getting rid of that Debilitating Shout is very important, so it will stop that at least. So Skjall, obviously, being a Tyrannical instance, he does not benefit from Tyrannical. He only benefits from Fortified, so he's quite easy to kill off here. And with that gone, 100% on trash, and now we move on to Hellia. And ladies and gentlemen, by no means is this instance over yet, because Hellia on this plus 25 is also very scary.
Incredibly scary. They always have to watch out for the first phase here as they have the double grasping tentacles coming out, and they will soon have the destructor tentacle coming out of the ship here. You will periodically see the front of the ship just having different holes cut into it here as more tentacles start spawning, or as tentacles periodically come up into any of the gaps into the ship here. Very important to make sure they're killing the 6 tentacles before they are actually able to get back to Hellia here. So I'd be looking at quickly burning down the first 3 tentacles that we see,
yep,
and maybe maybe looking at just taking the Bloodlust immediately as they actually enter Helia's face.
And the great bit about these three tentacles in particular is that you can get some good AoE overlap on them from some of these classes, so that's very nice. And of course, you're going to always have to have Sevs right there and then when the Destructor Tentacles actually appear, because otherwise they can just turn around and whack someone, or even just whack the entire boat if nobody's near it.
I like seeing the earlier Bloodlust here. I was actually a little unsure of how quickly they'd be able to kill the Grasping Tentacles here, because there is actually a delay between, you know, more Grasping coming up or Destructors coming up, but a lot of times it's that second Destructor Tentacle, which would be such a pain to deal with, as you're seeing Muscle Brock going down, being hit by one of the tentacles under the sides there. Very important to make sure they're dealing with that second Destructor Tentacle, because it can just have so much HP to deal with, and it does put a little bit of a timer in the head of the group here, because, like I said, there is the delay between tentacle spawns here. You need to make sure you're killing the Destructor before another one does end up spawning here, and the rest of the group here is able to focus on the last two Grasping Tentacles,
yep,
as the tank is going to be able to deal with the next Destructor Tentacle that pops up here, and not have to actually worry about any of the AoE that can happen from it if a Destructor Tentacle is left untanked.
Yeah, their next res is a long way away, so they need to deal with that second phase very effectively. Shell's Angels, meanwhile, on the other side is hoping that the Pogchamp does actually wipe while they're killing off Skjall, and they'll eventually be moving on to Helia themselves. But this Destructor Tentacle is going to go down, and then with that, just a few more Grasping Tentacles, and they should be okay with one going very low. Another Destructor Tentacle pops up. Sev's going to move into position to tank that quite nicely, and then from here on out, it's time for the ship to blow up.
At this point, you will see Helia just crashing into the front of the ship here. Important to watch any of the holes that are going to be spawning in the middle of the ship here, because they are in fairly set locations to where they can end up spawning. It's always important to note that there is a pretty substantial gap in between where those tentacles can actually spawn, so you're not going to see, you know, entire chunks of the ship being removed. So a lot of times, the safest areas are going to be on, like, say, the left or right sides of the ship, or as you're going to see, that, you know, the tanks maybe, or elves right on this side, directly in front of the boss while still being right next to one of the holes that have spawned.
All right, so Sev's just tanking it off to the left-hand side here. The breath's going to be on the right. Muscle Bra's going to move just to make sure that he's nowhere near that. Separate up for the quaking. And thankfully for them, they actually don't have much issues in melee range. Oh, Heru's gone down on the other side. But because, you know, it is quaking and they don't have that many melee members, and everyone's going down actually on the side of Shell's Angels, that's a catastrophe for them.
At this point, they just weren't able to get the battle res off to them, and they probably were thinking that they would just be stuck in Helia's phases forever here. So they do have to restart the entire fight without Bloodlust here. It will just put so much emphasis on their Destructor Tentacle damage going into the repull here on the side of Shell's Angels here, because the Destructor Tentacle spawns so quickly here. You're even seeing, even after Pogchamp had killed their second Destructor, the third one came out really soon after the kill that went out there. So it's so important to make sure they're having, you know, the single target damage focus on this 25 Tyrannical. It will be very rough for them to actually get through this.
Yeah, as long as they can continue to interrupt what is interruptible here on Helia, which is just a nice, easy rotation, it should be fine. Intermission phase comes up now. It's not like our 20s in time trials where everyone was looking for that elusive one phase. No, no, no. 25 Tyrannical. This is going to take quite a while indeed. Actually, all positioning towards the front here to try and dodge everything. And then once Helia comes straight back up, it's straight back to that DPS.
Yeah, at this point, you know, they're just focusing on their positioning and watching out for any of the tentacles that will end up despawning here. Shell's Angels, again, working on the Destructor Tentacle first, making it the top priority for every single DPS to be able to get onto, because the next one is going to come out very quickly. And at that point, you even have the threat of maybe two spawning if they're going to be too slow on the second Destructor Tentacle is coming out. Divine Field, actually probably Purgatory here. Hero going down here. I'm not sure if they're going to be able to actually deal with this Destructor Tentacle in time. They're just going to have everybody die here. If they lose a single DPS, they're just in so much trouble here to be able to deal with. Not having Bloodlust is just such a disaster scenario for Shell's Angels.
And Method Pogchamp looks well rehearsed is the best way to look at this right now. They lost one person in that first phase, Musclebra. He went down. Insta get him back up. They look confident here in the ultimate phase here for Helia with good division. Of course, Muscle Bros being tested quite a bit because the breath always seems to be on his side, but that's not too bad. Just a little bit of a sidestepping is fine. But 75% now on Helia, and then she is very, very close to death as another breath for Muscle Bros side. That's fine. That's fine.
Hey, at least all the other casters don't end up having to move. Maybe he knows something that we don't, that it's always going to be targeting him or something along those lines. That, you know, SJ is end up going down. They do not have another battle res left available to them. They don't necessarily need to have him up for to be able to deal with the rest of this fight, but it does kind of just prolong it here. But with the way that Shell's Angels has been going, they have so many problems to be able to actually deal with these Destructor Tentacles in time, and just kind of losing some DPS here and there, maybe to a little bit of the tilt, having to deal with this boss here. It doesn't look like Shell's Angels is going to be able to catch up anytime soon.
Yeah, I don't think so. It's not like there's any kind of hard DPS check on this boss when it comes to, you know, any extra mechanics. Say, like, for example, on Harboron, where, you know, some of those adds can really cause some of your members some problems if you don't have enough DPS. Again, the bait out here for Muscle Bra on this right-hand side. Good stuff. 3% here left, really, for Hellier to be able to eventually go down. And Sev's doing well on the other side. And Shell's Angels trying to catch up, but I think it's all for naught at this point.
Yeah, you're going to see another Destructor Tentacle coming up very soon on the side of Shell's Angels. Here, so they did a good job being able to get the second one down in time. Next one's going to be coming up very soon. They're trying to get this Grasping down to be able to get it out of the way here, just to try to get out of this phase. Because, like you said, once you go into the Hellier phase, the DPS race has really just kind of ended. Yep. You're not really worrying about that too much at this point. Just following through with mechanics, making sure nobody's ended up falling into any of the cracks into the vessel there, and just trying to survive as best as you can.
My breath towards the middle now. Muscle Bra gets a little bit of a relaxing moment and actually switches through straight to the middle here. And so Dr. J taking a bit more damage, and then another intermission phase. Very close now, but overall, it's great control from them, and it's really good to see this kind of execution coming out from them on their counterpick. They took Shell's Angels, where a lot of people thought they were not going to go, and they've proved their worth.
And in many cases, that's one of the things to always watch for is, you know, as you're looking at live servers and who, you know, the easiest ways to be able to push on live servers and how much teams actually are practicing high-level tyrannical keys. Having that as their counterpick has worked so well for Pogchamp as they're taking game two.
And they take two, as you guys have said, on Uncharted Waters, a very, very high key for a Maw of Souls. And you can see all the way from Harboron all the way to Hellia just how difficult those bosses really were. A fantastic counter.
Just like in the European regionals.
Now, this Court of Stars will decide it. Who goes to the grand final? Shell's Angels will either get their rematch, or we will have an all-method grand final.
Taken away into the Court of Stars and having a nice, relaxing boat ride with my good friend Kurt.
No, I've decided this one isn't relaxing.
Not at all.
Play heavy metal music.
Right.
You guys, I'm sick of these relaxing boat rides, all right? It's going to be heavy metal music all the way. And, well, okay, I'll be right.
That's the hype we need.
Yeah, there you go. It's game three.
Game three here between Shell's Angels and Method Pogchamp. Starting off, of course, like we said, with the boat ride going into this. It's very important to make sure that we're looking at the different routes that are going to be, you know, opening up to the different groups. We're dealing with Tyrannical, Teeming, and Necrotic. So a lot of these big pulls, we're looking at how well they're going to be able to actually take down the mobs quickly, moving on to the bosses. And both sides we've seen in the past, you know, loving to bring in extra trash and into the bosses, and be able to get that extra cleave damage, the extra rogue damage going into it. But it also puts that extra timer on the DK's head, on the tank's head, of how long they can stay in fighting the trash, contributing damage, and how quickly they have to run out and move around.
Important to note as well, we only saw one Court of Stars as a counterpick throughout the entirety of the tournament, and it was from Shell's Angels, going into that first map pool, which is the plus 23s, and they were going up against Gulch Trotters. This time around, a little bit more difficult when you're going, obviously, from that 23 to the 25, but it shows that they have mastery over the dungeon. And one thing that was important to note as well is that a lot in our regionals, we saw people going to docks and pulling a lot from there. This time around this tournament, we didn't see too much of that in our first game on court.
And a lot of times they try to hold off on the docks pull because it is on that tyrannical setting where you really want to be able to use Bloodlust on the boss in the first opportunity. Seb's doing a great job grabbing together all these mobs here. Both sides actually just moving past you know, the first trash packs we usually see here, and actually moving directly onto the bridge leading up to Patrol Captain Gerdo here. Always important to make sure you're watching out for any of the sabers that can be leaping onto different targets, putting up an extremely nasty dot as you're seeing Doru having to deal with his right now, not being able to be dispelled, unfortunately. So at this point, you're just being able to deal with that heavier dot, making sure it's a single target focus, and then having to deal with a construct here and the healing that it can put out, that healing aura around it. So important to make sure you're focusing it down and getting it interrupted constantly.
And that's why you see even just Muscle Bra turning around and getting onto that saber, right? Because as much as you would like to be AoEing in these massive, massive packs that they're trying to pull, some of these threats are too much to leave alone. Want to stay away from those two constructs at the bottom, that they don't patrol too far forward. Shell is well far away from that on the side of Method Pogchamp. So they'll be moving up on towards the first boss. And the one interaction that you can have on this dungeon is the fact that that potion is available to everybody. So, you know, the Captain Gerdo here isn't much of a threat once you actually get into his threshold.
That's right. And always important to note, you know, through Fort of Stars, where you have the different buffs, like you said, the only actual tertiary buff or external buff that you really can get is poisoning Patrol Captain Gerdo here. And at this point, you. Both poisons are going off. Both healers doing a great job shutting down any of the pylons to reduce the amount of reinforcement guards that are going to come up here. You are seeing them actually just pulling in the extra little worms in the side of Shell's Angels here, finding a little bit extra single target damage, getting the Starfall, just obliterating these adds as rapidly as possible here. And again, Gerdo going to be casting very soon, of course, his just rooting effect or his slowing effect, which will deal ticking damage until you jump a couple times. This can also be dispelled or, you know, negated by just having shapeshifts or freedoms or anything like that. Arcane Lockdown coming out, quickly getting the freedom out in advance, and then just dispelling another one of the melee on the side of Syrah as he just continues to jump.
I feel like Shakespeare himself wrote Captain Gerdo's fight when it comes to poisoning a little bit of a potion and calling guards to get rid of intruders. That's exactly what Shakespeare would have liked. But
you would know better than anyone.
I guess so, yeah. Even I shouldn't have even brought it up now that I think about it. Never mind. Oh, apparently I'm Irish, though, so yeah.
That's what Mama Jack says. 43% left onto Shell's Angels here as we are just taking him down quickly here. And I like being able to see that extra focus out of Syrah, making sure he's actually diving out of melee here to almost actually end up diving back in to actually get hit by the laser here. But the focus, the focal point there is getting out of melee so that you're not going to be actually in any of the other AoE effects that Gerdo will spawn here. Dispelling one target as you are jumping to make sure that you are removing your debuff. Once your debuff's been removed, you're able to safely get back into melee and contributing that extra DPS.
The one issue here, whilst Captain Gerdo's about to end up falling here for Shell's Angels, is that I'm a bit concerned if I'm Method Pogchamp here in this counter pick from Shell's Angels. 40% trash to 26. Shell's Angels knew exactly how much trash they could get away with that first pull over towards that tower, whereas Method Pogchamp was having a little bit of a harder time with that.
Yeah, we've seen, you know, a nice little parkour out of the side of Syrah, running around the construct that is actually up the stairs from Gerdo's room here, making sure he's actually able to get around all of those mobs. That way he'll be able to actually open up the door. So you'll probably see one death onto both sides here after Gerdo, which would be the Holy Paladins, to be able to actually just open up the gates for the rest of the team. Shell's Angels here working on some of the trash here right before, you know, the usual checkpoint that will be coming up here. Be able to quickly take this down and open up the path if they need to be able to get some extra trash mobs, trash percentage, which they probably will end up doing to be able to get the docks, and probably going to be getting one of the extra mini-bosses at the same time.
Similar strat coming out from Elzerat as well here, so you can actually watch that in full motion whilst we're watching Shell's Angels obviously clean up some of that trash. So that's nice to see all of these angles whilst continue on with this race. And it's all about finding the enforcers from this point on. Where are they going to be spawning? They've already taken one, and they're going to be catching... Oh, no, that's actually an Inquisitor. That's not the enforcer.
Yeah, dealing with the double Inquisitor pack here as they're grabbing, of course, only the Shadow Mistresses and all of those going out. Having to watch out for, of course, the impacts, which can be extremely deadly if they're getting any kind of casts off. But always watching out for these Inquisitors because they can double tick you, as you're seeing people dropping incredibly low there. It deals so much damage out on the entire group. So you're having a couple deaths going out on the side of Pogchamp here. The double Inquisitor pack can be so lethal here when they're getting those eye storms off, having the eyes just constantly ticking onto targets. Even if you are getting the stuns out and the interrupts onto them, they still can actually tick onto you. So important to watch out for the Searing Glares that are dropping Elzrat and Muscle Broad down low just again here. Such a deadly pack that they have to watch out for.
And this is why they bring them all the way down to towards where these gates are, because they know that the checkpoint for them is going to be right on the other side of these gates. So even if they do have deaths, they can be right back into the action as fast as possible. Big, big damage. Shell actually goes down on this right-hand side here as the Warlock falls. Purgatory's been popped. Elzrat's gone down as well. They really want to make sure they can get everyone back in, but it looks like there's going to be a full team wipe, and they're not going to be able to kill off this in totality.
Yeah, and the Construct actually was at like 5% HP on the side of Pogchamp. They just weren't able to finish it off here. At this point, they're building the Enforcer on the side of Shell's Angels along with the Inquisitor Patrol going out here. Very important to make sure they're watching out for the positioning, because they kind of had to pull it out into the open field where they were not able to line of sight the Enforcer's debuff that they put out. Harrow is going down because he did end up, you know, receiving the debuff. He was not able to actually run out quick enough. Divine is just kind of running for his life as he's going into this, trying to drop his necrotic stacks, but I do believe he was able to drop them just in time here. Zero dropping pretty low as they're just having to get everybody back together, trying to make sure they're able to stabilize here. It's such an awkward pull to be able to do, especially when you're having to deal with the teaming and necrotic that are going out to it, but making sure you're watching out for the Fell Detonations here, getting back up with the group here, trying to stabilize, trying to get, you know, the nerves a little bit calm to get ready back together here.
And Method Pogchamp on the other side has got to be sweating buckets right now. Shell's Angels is on the verge right now with this 76%, with them so far ahead, not only in terms of trash percentage, but also good on deaths too. And they are on the verge of being able to get to that final and get their rematch, get their opportunity at redemption up against Method NA. And we're going to I'm a cut you,
you know, of course, having to watch out for the many whirling blades that she will be spawning out here. You will periodically just AoE around her, putting up quite a nasty dot. I actually love the timing out of Ashine, where he made sure that he actually timed his DFA until just after her cut actually went out here. So love the planning as you're seeing it. You just quickly stepping out for the whirling blades, getting back into melee, contributing that extra damage here, as you are seeing them pulling the Mistress and, of course, the Hound next to it to provide a little bit extra cleave opportunities for the rest of the group here. And at that point, you're just trying to clear up just the remaining trash that will not be too lethal or too bothersome, really, going after there. And both times, Shell's Angels just mopped up those impacts so cleanly.
Method Pogchamp stabilized, 45% though, so it's going to take quite a while for them to get things done. That's going to be another Inquisitor that just wanting to clean up all of these packs. With them moving around as they do, you want as much room as possible with the Enforcers, because again, as you say, the felt destination, you really want to be able to line of sight that whilst that's going on here with Aimakuchu.
Yeah, you're seeing Divine Field actually picking up the dot. You are seeing Syrah pop in his Hand of Sacrifice to help, you know, stabilize Divine as he's getting quite low, being able to actually deal with this. Divine just trying to drop his necrotic stacks. They're getting very heavy. You're already doing a great job hopping into bear form, getting the taunt off to help actually reduce that, as you are seeing another Enforcer coming out that they're going to be able to start working on here, making sure they're going to quickly transition into the next mini boss.
Yeah, it's really nice. Just kind of very, very clean play. There's so much movement involved, but if you can do it, it's extremely, extremely rewarding. So Aimakuchu goes down, Enforcer is killed. Here comes our next bodyguard here so that they can just continue on, eventually getting towards the next boss.
That's right. And with the Enforcers, of course, they do have some more random spawns to it. So you always have to look at the different options available to you. As you've seen, Pogchamp having Hellsrat and SJ going down here, dealing with the Inquisitor pack again. And they are so dangerous to actually have to watch out for here. Cannot stress that enough. Even in a non-fortified scenario, not being able to get the proper interrupt or stun or grip onto them can be a pain. Pogchamp again pulling that Inquisitor pack into Aimakuchu here to actually get started with that the next set of mini bosses here. They still have a ways to go to be able to catch up with Shell's Angels.
And Disintegration Beam here actually can be line of sighted as it's being cast. Sometimes you're able to get that, and that's why they're tanking it on this corner. Sometimes you're not able to do it in just the small window that you're given, so you will see them kind of ride that out. But as you can see, an attempt on it was there, unsuccessful, so now they're just going to have to heal through that damage.
Yep, and of course, it's really nice for the healer that they never end up getting targeted by this Disintegration Beam if there are other targets available to you. So at that point, the healer's able to kind of just sit out there, not have to actually worry about getting the line of sight here, and he is able to focus on the hero, who actually has a ton of stacks here. There's going to be really heavy damage that he has to watch out for, but Syrah does an excellent job making sure he's able to stabilize him.
Now that I think about it, Balgar the Watchful, what kind of title that is, that for a watcher or a beholder? But you are a watcher, you are a beholder, and you're the Watchful. I want something more impactful as a title.
Is it only because he has one eye? Do you think he's just not going to be as watchful? Is it just because of his bodily makeup that you have a problem with that?
I'm saying his peripheral vision isn't very good.
He can't control that, Kolaris. Why do you have to mock him?
There you go. Well, I like mocking it. It's okay.
Oof. And you're seeing the rest of the group getting a position here. They are going to be looking at pulling, of course, the boss and the last of the mini bosses together to be able to complete the last of their trash percentage here. If you do end up pulling the full boss, the second boss, Talix Flamewreath, with one of her bodyguards, with one of her mini bosses, you will be able to actually run out the gates to be able to move away, which will then cause her to despawn, but not her bodyguard. You'll then be able to actually deal with the mini boss at the same time as you're dealing with that dock pull. So Doru, again, not quickly tagging the boss, getting into travel form, start running away as quickly as it can, as you're seeing the wild charge coming out there, making sure he's going to be able to get out of the group. You're then going to see Talix actually end up despawning here. They grab the mistress, and they're going to be able to have the mini boss coming up with the rest of the dock pull here. Quite dangerous to make sure you're getting everything set up, but once you can get everything in together here, it just is such an effective and clean pull that you're able to get together.
Yeah, it works out very well. Solar Beam being utilized as well, silencing as much of that as possible and getting the interrupts from them from the spinning crane kick. Going to continue on with this damage here. And again, our little mini boss is inside there, taking just cleave damage as all of this is going down. Shell's Angels really syncing this up very, very nicely. They're going to have that Bloodlust in about 50 seconds later on for whenever they need it. So again, just a very well ironed out dungeon. Only 3 deaths on their side compared to the 10 right now on Method Pogchamp that just have had a hard time here.
they've had a harder time, and it's also showing the preparation on the side of Shell's Angels, where they've done a great job being able to actually have proper pulls going into this. Like, for example, this looks so clean and so great as they're doing it, but it's not easy. You know, they have to be able to make sure they're shutting down the Arcanist, which can just put out one debuff that could just destroy the entire group here. You have to make sure that you're trying to interrupt the guards who can put up, you know, the extra damage reduction for themselves. You have to be watching out for Jashario, who will be putting the Shockwave, which will be putting out really deadly stuns, especially when you're in a double melee environment. Having everything stacked up and piled up together with animations overlapping here really shows how well they're able to execute here, and this is the Shell's Angels that was able to beat Method EU in the regionals.
And now moving on to the next boss here, Shell's Angels has a good opportunity being able to continue furthering that lead forwards, and they're going to pull it on the way back here. There's a few patrols around that frontal area that you don't particularly want to be fighting near.
Yeah, I really like seeing the Bloodlust coming out of here on Shell's Angel side to be able to start working onto Flame Wreath here. This is actually one of the fights I really wish we had healing meters for, because it is such an intense race for them to actually burn this boss down quickly. Going into the last boss, for example, is just more of an attrition fight. This is incredibly deadly here, having to worry about all the damage that the imps can be putting out if they're getting off any single cast. You also have to be watching out for the Withering Soul coming out of Flame Wreath here, but the increasing damage at a burning intensity here, always watching as how the Paladin is going to be able to deal with all, any of the damage going out, because your healing is more focused on burst through Beacon of Virtue here, so having situations where you're not quite getting your Virtue back off cooldown here, and having Imp Cast going off is such a terrifying combination, as you're seeing everyone kind of drop into 50%, Virtue's back available, everyone's topped off, everyone's safe. Having the downtime areas where you're not able to have it, that's why you're seeing the Tears Deliverance going out. I'd love to be able to see the preparation in a Seer where you're saying, I don't quite have my Virtue back yet. Let me get something here to help ease it as I'm going back into this. He actually does also pop Devotion Aura, which is fantastic here, as they're getting into this deadly area where they don't quite have all the CDs. The Imps are not getting annihilated as quickly as they were at first. You then transition into the Solar Beam here to start reducing that damage here. You might be seeing Seer actually just popping wings to finish it off at the very end here. Great discipline by him.
I mean, the boss is almost dead and you finished your point. I appreciate it. That's really well done. They're also stacking up just to make sure that all of those Imps spawn in a similar spot with one another. Of course, you can burn them down quite quickly, interrupt them quite easily as well. So Flame Wreath, not too big of an issue, even on like a tyrannical setting when it comes to at least the mechanics involved, aside from the healing, of course.
That's right, and you're seeing Divine Shield actually went up as he popped Blessing of Sacrifice onto one of his members here, just help easing the pain as they're going into this. Right now, this is the scary situation. He doesn't actually have any CDs left available to them, as Pogchamp is ended up wiping here, having to actually try to pull the rest of the Enforcer and try to finish it off, as Shell's Angels is having such a clean Flame Wreath kill, just pulling further and further away here.
Plenty of solar beams, and then they will move into the masquerade and find things. That's not a Nightborn. What is this? And then we'll switch back on in. So finding the clues, then eventually going to find the intruder, which we're all very used to when it comes to this area of Legion. Intruders are plentiful.
Oh, an illusion. What are you hiding?
Exactly.
The rest of the team is just running around to just go spread it out, but I got to give props again to Seer for his immense control over the course of this fight.
Yeah.
25 Tyrannical, making sure that they have such immense control going out of this, and I love being able to see, you know, those intense healer fights that in many cases we only really get to see when we're going into these higher level Tyrannical keys, and being able to see how well someone's able to kind of stretch their mana out, especially when we're not getting any kind of defensive buffs, any kind of mana buffs, or any damage buffs going in.
I bear in mind there with Shell's Angels, when you come into this little masquerade part, that was a really quick find by them. So not only were they far ahead, but now they're even further ahead. And going into this small mini boss here, there's a few things you've got to be careful of. Obviously, the Carrion Swarm that's going to be coming out in a small AoE cone. So you just got to be able to make sure you're turning that away from your team. And then the Cripple, which is a bit irritating, but not too impactful.
Yeah, and it also gives an opportunity for Seer to be able to pop his Sethus if he wants to, just to get that quick dispel out onto whoever gets hit by the Cripple. Be able to pop out some extra damage here. And you're right, it does an incredible amount of damage, that Shadow Bolt volley here, and a lot of times you'll be looking at just having the player step back a little bit to make sure they're able to remove the debuff from the Shadow Bolt volley, which will cause them to take increased damage, and then from there they're going to be able to make sure they're getting a hit again once it actually ends up falling off here. So watching your positioning and maybe your distance a little bit to make sure you're not dropping too low, getting, of course, you know, everybody topped off before they do have, you know, the next one coming back up.
Yeah.
So you're doing a great job just running away, running ahead to be able to start opening up the gates as soon as possible as the tank is able to grab the key.
Who's going to channel it? Is it the tank? Yeah, so nicely done. Picks up, gets good to go. I always insist on channeling it, even if I'm not the tank. I'm just like, oh, it's my key. nobody else's key, it's mine. So Seer is going to then eventually open this up, and then we'll be moving on to the final boss as we find a small meeting. Whoa, what's going on? Oh, you found us. Who would have guessed?
Oh, it's quite a hot and bothered situation here, as you are seeing, you know, Grand Magistrate Elisande quite embarrassed and just having to go here before leaving her her captain here to be able to finish this off.
I mean, she's off to mess with some hourglasses. I don't know what's going on up there. Just, we'll find out later, I suppose, in the Nighthold. Well, there you go.
Yeah, but Advisor Melandra's coming up here. You're going to be watching positioning here on Doru on the right side of your screen, making sure he's going to be baiting any of the Blade Surges out into that same location. They will then leave a copy of him, which will then be cast the Piercing Gale, and always having it in the same location makes it so much easier to be able to watch the positioning for the melee.
And that's why Doru is going to be stood on it and then just baits it out every single time, and it really just alleviates so many problems. Again, it's a tyrannical setting, so these bosses die slowly, but making sure that you have so much room to be able to work with here while you have things like that Blade Surge being able to go out is super important.
It's incredibly important. It also establishes consistency when you're going into it, making sure everything's going to be more or less the same location. And also important to note that during, of course, the slicing maelstroms that go out, any of the copies also pulse a little bit of damage here, so ensuring that they're all going to be in the same spot and that nobody's going to be standing around them as you're seeing that little AoE effect going out, it ensures that, you know, the damage on the entire group is going to be much reduced.
The only issue is that if Doru, for example, did mess up and was stood on there when that big slice does go down, he'd die pretty fast, but that's not going to be happening at this level, and it's kind of, he's not missing anything from this. It's not like he's missing extra damage or DPS, because he would have to be moving anyway from the next one that comes along, so it's just cleanliness.
It very much is cleanliness, and one thing that helps, especially with the healers, is being able to have a strong rotation throughout having good CDs, right? Yeah. So you'll have Divine Fields, Consumption, Leech, every other Slicing Maelstrom that goes out, and then in between that, you're going to be able to have the option, if you want to use Cephus as a healer, to be able to have your tank hop into Tornado like you're seeing. Divine gets dispelled, Syrah actually has the Cephus proc going into this, and then he has a huge haste buff that he's able to actually top off everybody here. Now, the damage from Slicing Maelstrom does have a cap. It increases by however many copies and clones that Melandris does end up spawning here, and it caps at around 3 or 4 stacks. So once you actually end up hitting the cap, even if you have Leech, even if you end up having the Cephus proc, you need to start rotating through other cooldowns here. As you're seeing on the side of Pogchamp, Elzrat going down, no battle res is left available to them as they're at 16% here, and that's just such a race for them. It's scary.
Yeah, hopefully they've got consumption up soon so they can actually get some leech off of this so they can all stay alive. One important thing is actually some of the imps weren't exactly controlled the perfect way that they wanted to. Some of them were separated out, and I think that was causing them a little bit of issues when actually dealing with the next wave coming along. Dr. J and Musselbrot very low. Musselbrot is going to go down 6%. Hopefully they should be able to do this. Tanks can survive quite a long time while that's going on, but back over to Shell's Angels. Still, strong control and strong overall presence of mind here in this final boss. Melandris is well practiced.
It's well practiced, and being able to know which targets are going to be needing the most healing, for example, the rogue. Oh my gosh, having everybody going down, 2% left onto Sebs right now.
Come on, Sebs!
So close to
be
able to deal with Flame Wreath. Does proc his purgatory here. There's so much damage going out. They are going down. 1% left onto Flame Wreath as they're not able to be able to deal with it. Shell's Angels here just ready to pull away and claim this victory. 18% left onto Melandris. They're getting the quick dispel out onto Divine as he did end up hopping into the tornadoes to help start removing those away. And they just have to be dealing with one more slicing to be able to actually finish out this series, really.
Dodging the Piercing Gales and doing well. They don't care about these last ones as that Slicing Maelstrom's going to come in, do some damage, but it doesn't matter. Syrah's still got plenty of mana left, and 10% left. Shell's Angels at this point is going to be able to get themselves in a spot where they can try and get revenge from that upper bracket here. They've performed so well throughout this tournament so far with only 7% left. They counterpicked effectively, strongly, Jack, and they are going to be able to make it back into that grand final.
That's right. As you're seeing, just the last of the Slicing Maelstroms that they have to deal with. 1% left for Shell's Angels, the second Method team that they have taken down in this tournament.
The question starts to be answered. Are they the Method Slayers? Well, they got one more team that they need to be looking at now. But really quickly, major shout-outs to Method Pogchamp. They managed to extend this all the way to that Game 3 with a fantastic counterpick. But now it is going to be Shell's Angels that looks even more dominant on their counterpick and convincingly gets themselves to the rematch. Trekkie, an absolutely beautiful, beautiful dungeon by them.
Yeah, it was a perfect counter pick as well, and we could see that Pogchamp maybe hadn't practiced that one and were more biting to do good on Maw. And Shell's Angels just dealing with this one very strong, knowing exactly what pulls to deal with, knowing exactly how to deal with them very effectively, and it just showed.
I mean, there were just like little things too, even on their lust use, right? Use it on Flame Wreath instead of actually using it on Melandris, because Melandris, that ramping damage, it actually does have a cap. You look on Flame Wreath, it's not going to have a cap. You want to use the heroism there.
Yeah, and Sierra really just put on an incredible clinic of what you need to be doing as a healer to be able to properly deal with that. But it also relies on the rest of your DPSers, for example, to have incredible focus onto those imps.
Hey, so I'm here with Sierra, and so congratulations on getting into top two. How does it feel? That was an incredible series.
Heart still pounding, not quite sunk in yet. The boys played really well. Really, really well. I'm so happy with that. So happy.
And so you're going against Method NA. It's going to be a rematch. Is there anything you want to say to the boys?
Yeah, get ready, because you know where you're going. We're going to take you there, and we're going to do what we just did there.
Ooh, those are some harsh words. We'll see what's going to happen in the next series. It's going to be an intense one. Back to you guys at the desk.
Sierra with a little bit of trash talk coming out there. I will say, Sierra.